I've had a right bust up. You won't believe it. You wouldn't believe the buzzard. Thanks for coming, right? I just got flung out of blind date, right? Three of my mates was on blind date, right? They're the blokes who was on blind date. One of my mates, the woman, was on it. And I was in the audience, and I was sitting there in the audience quite happily, and they flung me out. They flung me out because I was sitting there going... Paul Newman, you remember Paul Newman, the actor? I've just seen him. I went to visit my mum in the old people's home, and he's there now. Fantastic. I'm a big fan of... I do believe that a man... I don't think as we come to the end of the 20th century that a man should be embarrassed about wanting to smell nice. That's all right. So whenever I have a shower, I get myself done, I have a little bit of one of them big... You know those long things that you have in the shower? That you rub all over yourself. Anyway, and then I always spray myself with some nice parfum de toilette. But this one I've started wearing, but whenever you go, women come up to you and go, hey, fatso, hey! Hey! So I don't wear it anymore. No, that's the stuff, what's it, Gia? Oh, look at this. I don't think this is going to catch on, to be quite honest. I really don't. Life-size models they've started making of Jeanette Cranky, look. I've got this stuff. Oh, man, is it fantastic or is it absolutely fantastic? I've got in my house, I've got a big garden, as you probably know. And what I've got a lot of tomatoes, awful lot of tomatoes, a lot of cabbages, a lot of potatoes, a lot of cucumbers. And sometimes I go out there in the morning and it's a cacophony. All you can hear is... Because it's cold, the frost gets on them. But what I do now is I use this. This is absolutely perfect. Vegetable cough remover. Now, you can't beat that, basically, ladies and gentlemen. I've got this. This is what happens if people come around my house. My friends come around. I've got a lot of friends. A lot of them in the world of entertainment. Some of the world of sport. Sally Gunnell was around the other day. Jumping over the sofa and that. And she hurt her leg and we had to take her home. I tend to give them that. It's a very refreshing drink. It's grape juice. Red grape juice. That's lovely. So it's all just worth thinking about. If any Welsh people come round, obviously, just bung them a glass of that. They won't know. Sour grape juice. Right, let's have a look at what we've got, ladies and gentlemen. Let's have a look at what we've got in the dumb waiter. Let's see what we've got in here. Oh, now look at this. There's an old... Look. What's Miss Fanway up to? There's an old cigarette. You see that? Old cigarette stump, I believe. A dog end, they call that in the working class areas of the country. And a photo of Brian Blessed, the actor. Oh, let's have a look. What's she's... Coming down, my family. Ah, yes, yeah, that's very funny, my friend. Look at that, little bit of smoked ham there. Ha 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 ha. Very funny in a Welsh sort of way. As it happens, I'll tell you this, right? I'll tell you this. Where's that chair gone? Where's the big green chair? I'm sorry. Oh, sorry, it's there. No, I'll tell you what it is. I'll tell you what, I have a problem. You must have read all the research in the United States of America where they never lie, right? The more good-looking you are, the more handsome you are, the less peripheral vision you've got. Absolutely true. There is a direct correlation, they reckon, between your ability to see there and your ugliness. So if you're looking now forward and you put your hand there and you can see it, you're ugly. But if you can't, if you blink it like that, means you're good looking. Something to do with the genes, chromosomes, hormones, vitamins, that kind of thing. As it happens, very lucky to find me here, because normally this time of night I'd be out and about. You've joined me, a bit of a tragic day you've joined me on today. My uncle Nico's died and it's his funeral today. I'm just waiting for the rest of my family, most of the mourners, to turn up. You know, I'm tall, right? I'm about 6'6". He used to play for professional basketball for the LA Lakers. But my uncle Nico, right, he was the tallest man you've ever met. Big, tall man, very skinny man. And as I say, it's his funeral today. We're waiting here. He's coughing here. He's been lying on his face here. And as soon as the family come, we're going to be with me and about 14 other lads. Anyway, 14 on each time. We're going to be pallbearers. Take him along and bury him, basically. Just trying to find a big enough hole. I was going to, ladies and gentlemen, this is quite an embarrassing moment. I was going to show some a film that I made, but my television's not here. Oh. I tell you, the Uncle. I didn't realise three sort of handsome people know peripheral vision. This is a film I made. As you know, I make a lot of films, make a lot of TV programs. I was approached by the people who are in charge of the education of the young people of this country. They said, we want you to make a public education film. Because it's not like it used to be when we was kids, when you could go out, you could do anything, you could play in the park, you could run around on the road. These days, it's much, much more dangerous world for children. They said, can you make a film for children who might find themselves in this particular situation, maybe in the inner city? So this is the movie that I made with some friends of mine from the United States of America. There you go, this is a Barlean brawler. The art of staying alive in beer joints, biker bars, and other fun places. So this is what I've got. Here we go. Let's have a look.
Hey.
I don't think I need to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I think pretty much speaks for itself in the grammar of film, baddie. Anytime you see the long shot come, the fuck, baddie.
Give me a tree frog, I gotta take a piss.
You got it, bro.
What you have there is the classic baddie signal into other baddie move. And so both baddies now, is something bad's going to happen.
You asshole!
And the bad thing that was going to happen, obviously, was the acting. But now let's go, let's take them through it. Here we go. So there you go, kids. This is the kind of thing that could happen if you were going to get involved in a brawl in a bar room. I just want to introduce you to my three friends that helped me make this. Your mates, right? Oh, they're called Jim, Tom, Fred, Bill, Nicky, Carmine. My friends have got just daddy cool names.
Greetings. I'm Baden Quinn. Mark Animal McYoung. Mike the Amazing Eagle Hanick.
Mike the Amazing Eagle Hanick, by the way. He was called Animal McYoung because he was a bit of an animal. He used to fight. He was called the Amazing Eagle because he used to try and fly off the top. He lived in a nest in a tree. But fine, guys. And here they are anyway with the education. The first thing, of course, is the rules of fighting.
One of the most fundamental concepts that you need to know to avoid trouble in these kind of places is that of personal physical space. In the animal kingdom, this is called territory. When another animal of the same species enters one animal's territory, there is going to be conflict.
Now, that's absolutely true. And nowhere is it more true than in this jungle environment here. Now, ladies, you might not understand, but the gentleman will fully understand this. By the way, this is a gentleman's toilet, not a small church. Okay? Here we go. This is the kind of problem you can run into if you're not careful.
It's the same in the human world. An insensitivity or an ignorance of personal space...
Hey, don't sit next to me!
...is the root of a number of fights and altercations.
These guys are so hard, right? Everyone wants to fight them to the point where they couldn't just go out in the street and say, like, who's next? They had to have a little appointments booked.
It's important to remember that when somebody's interviewing you for punch-out potential, one of the things that he's looking for is...
Yes, you see? And you're being interviewed, wear a suit. That's always that. Wear a suit. And can I just say, I don't want to insult you as an 11-year-old boy, but that is the worst picture of a footballer I've ever seen. What we're going to do now is look at a very sign. You're all, of course, fully conversant with Funakogi Undo. Funakogi Undo. Pushing and pulling. Okay? You push, you pull. It's one of the basic arts of any martial art and of any kind of fighting at all. And you're going to see it here in its purest form. Funakogi Undo. Push.
And pull.
One critical concept you need to understand to make this pulling movement work is that you drop your hips before affecting the pull.
How often have you gone wrong there? How often in the car park of the pub have you come around several hours later covered in blood and thought, I didn't drop my hips? Fooling myself in front of all my friends, I didn't drop my head. So watch, and hey, look, let's see it in action now with a woman. Here's a thug, grab, so she pushes, then push, and there you go. Now, what could be simpler than that? Funa Kogi Undo. I'll tell you the one thing we did, though, when we were making this film, we had some of the finest American actors at our disposal, and we used them.
Finally, we again look at teaming up this fundamental push-pull movement with environmental obstructions. In this case, another truck.
Right, watch the acting.
This consciousness of identifying the concepts and...
Some of the finest acting in the world, ladies and gentlemen, from, if you'll join me, with a nice round of applause for our special guest star, Mr. Bill Cosby, ladies and gentlemen. My very good friend, D.M. Thomas, he sent me this book. He wants me to read through it and see if I can make any changes. It's Divine Brown. You may remember Divine Brown. She was involved in an incident, to put it lightly, with Hugh Grant. And he interviewed her and said, I want to write a book about your experience in the car. Was there anything that you remember from what Hugh said to you? And he's publishing this book anyway soon. We'll be reading it. And, I didn't see that so for now. Right, what have we got for you? Oh, yeah. Who knows where Seattle, Washington is? Yeah, of course you do. I went out there because I make some programs from the police. I used to make them in this country, but now the police won't have anything to do with me because of the problems that I had with the... I don't want to go into it. They're doing all right now. Their careers are back on the rail. But I went over to America and I made this program, and it's going around with the police out there. Let's have a look. Here we go. Oh, I'll tell you what, lads, just for the lads, there's a woman in this. Whoa! All I can say is, and you'll know what I mean. Here we go.
When I came back from the manager's office, he was standing on his brother's front porch.
She's beautiful. She's absolutely beautiful. Oh. All right. No, different tastes, different people.
I guess he came up behind me. I didn't see him because I can't see off to the side.
Scientific growth. You know nothing, all right? Don't go against science, because you'll just wind up looking stupid. Anyway, let's see the bloke. Oh, hang on, hang on. I've just got to say something about this. Have a look at this bloke. What do you know about him? You know, well, since he's American, he's a child of the 60s, bit of a hippie. He's the type. He's not Chinese, though, is he? He's not Chinese until he starts feeling guilty. Just happens. When I get a bit guilty, I do... that a lot. Some people get a bit sweaty. He turns Chinese. Simply that. Have a look.
Make you call us. She was hitting you? Where'd she hit you at?
She hit me all my top of my head.
Let me see your head.
A headache.
Let me see your head. Yeah, it looks okay to me.
Let's see if she can hit me. I've got a headache right now, but you won't hit me.
You're right. Okay. Did you hit her?
No, I took her head off my hair.
Absolute nonsense. Let's have a look.
Doesn't mean you're guilty. Okay.
It's just one slight problem, though. As I was filming this, I thought, I've seen that guy. I've seen him with his hair cut and with a beard and in a suit. And I'm sure I've seen him at police headquarters. in actual fact. It got a little bit strange then.
This means I have enough probable cause to go ahead and arrest you.
Then
for domestic violence, fourth degree.
What do you use these for?
Suddenly.
I do the same thing you guys do.
Handcuffs. What do you use these for? I'll do the same things you guys do. And suddenly, this is an undercover cop. The guy's on assignment here in this house, isn't it? And we've come along, blundered in, and nicked him, and it's kind of really tense.
Work for Martin Luther King, work for Officer Hobson.
Work for Martin Luther King?
Yes.
And Officer Hobbs?
Uh-huh.
Yes. What's this?
I don't work for them.
What's Tacoma, what's this badge thing?
Police badge.
Oh, looks like you made it up, huh?
No. I got given the badge. By Officer Hobson.
Cardboard, silver paper. Tacoma Police number one written on it. No, I'm real Pigman. And then it all goes downhill for him from there, look.
Yeah. Huh, so you're a police officer? What do you use this for, my friend?
What do you think I use it for?
I'm not into this stuff. Why don't you tell me?
When I want to get high, I get high.
So you're saying you put marijuana in here? Excuse me?
I didn't put it in, no.
But you do?
A friend of mine put it in, no.
I don't put it in, no. No, I'm trying to eat again. A friend of mine come along in there and put in marijuana in my pipe. I'm putting stuff with that.
I don't fit it in here.
Okay, so marijuana goes in here, though.
Yes, but it's my pipe. But
right.
I use it. But sometimes I do and sometimes I don't.
You don't use it, sometimes you do, sometimes you don't?
Right. I haven't been smoking it.
And you're a police officer? Okay. Before.
Hang on, there's a lovely little thing coming out there. By the way, I think the old Kevin Costner copper is a bit of a bastard anyway.
Okay. How many times have you been arrested before?
How many times have you been arrested before? If you get asked that question, you're on the horns of a dilemma because you say, right, now what do I say? If I say 26 times, then it's obviously going to, you know, prejudice my chance of a fair hearing, right? If I say not at all, then fine, they might not find out, they might not check the records, but if they do and they find out I've been nicked, then it's going to lead to trouble. I don't know, Christ, how many times have you been... And he decides in the end, the best thing to do, honesty, best policy. I will simply tell the truth. How many times have you been arrested?
I don't keep track.
I'm sorry, I haven't a bloody clue. I employ accountants for that kind of thing. I'll tell you what I want to do now, right? This is back to my fighting film. One of the important things, identifying the angle of attack. That's what it says, very clearly. And that's what we're going to do. Because, in fact, if you can see where an attack is coming from, if you're very quick, if you're very smart, if you've been trained, you can get out of the way, okay?
In order to step off the attack line, we first need to identify
sure.
the angle of attack.
Straight on.
Note that the attack line
knife.
Itself is the same here, whether it's a fist or a fist holding a knife. You must condition yourself to a...
Now, I'm telling you, don't you try this, right? This ain't for ordinary punters, right? This guy's a trained martial arts expert, and he's going to attempt to just get himself out of the angle of attack. So watch carefully, you might learn.
Immediately
there
perceive. Notice how this is going. Pay particular attention to footwork.
What's the footwork? Yeah.
Here, we're shifting to the inside. Notice the body rotation.
Fantastic.
He throws the hook. I'm moving in. My Taisabaki movement, my body shift, is moving my head out of the perfect focus of the blow. Failing to do this means you're not going to get any further with your defense, because here's what's going to happen.
You don't do that. You're gonna. And hey, let me tell you something. These guys ain't joking. These guys ain't jerking around here, okay? As they say in America. Because look at him. Look at him, right? If he hits you, that's like Hector Camacho there. If he hits, man, you're going down. You're going down like this.
Boom.
Richard Dunn is the only man who's ever gone down like that. Anyway, come on, let's have a look. Let's see the guys now. They're signing off. Oh, this guy here, you wouldn't think it, but he's Italian and he used to have a gondola.
When I was in Venice growing up, I was a young buck, and we did all this, these mistakes. And you know, there were 10 of us, and we were good. And now there's only 2 of us, and that's 15 years later. So that should act as a really serious reminder as to how serious this stuff can be.
Yeah, because 8 of them kind of met women, got married, and you two are the only jerks left. Anyway, I've got to go. They don't just do like movies. They do books and stuff. I think we can see their books.
These books by Mark Animal McYoung are available from Paladin. Book, A Bouncer's Guide to Barroom Brawling, is also available from Paladin Press.
Just incidentally, the one name missing from that bibliophile catalogue is Mike the Amazing Eagle Anek, but he has written a book. It is available in this country. Mike the Amazing Eagle Anek, How to Cope with Embarrassing Dopey Friends. $9.99 all good bookshops. I've got to go. See you later.
Tomorrow night at the same time, it's the first episode of the sparkling new show, Festival of Fun. Guaranteed laughs, we can tell you. Next tonight, Ellen, after Robin.
Well done, guys. Well done, everyone. Fine. Bob, lovely. Bob. Good show. Quick hey,
work.
What a great
quick
show.
No, quick work. I don't think it was that great. The audience weren't really there. They weren't laughing. I'm
You're
sorry,
joking.
Mate.
You're joking. They was fawning about, man. It was, like, no. Fantastic.
Come on. They weren't laughing, mate.
No. They see a silly boat room, and they're, like, very, very funny shots. Make a joke. Very, very funny thing. Oh, I love it.
Bob. I mean, look, what's that?
It's the British Comedy Award.
Look, just think about it. How many people do you think watch this show and just fall asleep out of boredom?
I don't keep track.